Welcome, this is Dr. G, and in this video, we will be talking about vitamin B5, pentathenic acid. Unless you're doing detailed, high-level, in-depth research on pentathenic acid, you most likely will not need to know too much about pentathenic acid itself. However, its active metabolite, CoA, that's important in all levels of metabolism, and that is why in this video, we will be primarily focusing on CoA and all the different pathways it belongs in. You got this. Come on, let's go. Let's first take a look at the structure of pentathenic acid. As you can see, it already looks quite complex, but when it gets metabolized to CoA, it becomes even bigger and more complex. Like other vitamin Bs, pentathenic acid is found in almost everything that we eat, so it's extremely rare to be deficient in pentathenic acid. And you can also take it as a supplement, usually in the form of calcium pentathenate. However, keep in mind there is another supplement that sounds very similar to pentathenic acid, and it's called pentathene. Although they belong in the same family of compounds, pentathene has a very different function than pentathenic acid. Pentathene is taken as a supplement to lower blood cholesterol. Let's take a look at the conversion of pentathenic acid into its active metabolite, coenzyme A or CoA. As you can see, it's a pretty long pathway with many steps, and a lot of these steps actually require ATP or energy. Now, in this video, I won't be going into the details of this pathway because it's going to take way too long for me to just repeat these enzyme names and say these intermediate names to you. I'm sure you can just read them and look at them yourself. And number two, I don't feel like there's anything crazy in this pathway that you need me for. I think you can just learn it yourself, memorize it yourself if you need to know it. I'm sure there's other great videos on YouTube that goes into way more details in these pathways if you need. So let's move on. Let's talk about coenzyme A. We already know it's synthesized from pentathenic acid and it requires ATP. But if you take a look at that pathway earlier, notice it also requires cysteine, which is one of two amino acids that contains the element sulfur. And that's important because that sulfur in the cysteine will end up as a thiol group in our coenzyme A when it's all said and done. And because our coenzyme A has a thiol group or an SH group, that's why when we're abbreviating coenzyme A, we can either abbreviate it as CoA or CoASH or CoASH. Just remember, they both mean the same thing. They both mean coenzyme A. Like its name suggests, coenzyme A is a coenzyme. Coenzymes help enzymes catalyze specific reactions. In the case of coenzyme A, that specific reaction is acyl group transfers. As our CoA is helping with the acyl group transfers, it's known as either an acyl CoA or an acetyl CoA. So the million-dollar question is, what is an acyl group? Well, this here is an acyl group. And as you can see, the acyl group here is attached to just a random compound that we don't really care about. Within the acyl group, we have an oxygen double bonded to a carbon, which is also bonded to an R. The R just represents a hydrocarbon chain. It could be of any length. Now, if the R group happens to be just a single carbon or a methyl group, then this is a special acyl group that we call acetyl group. So an acetyl group is just a very special type of acyl group where the R is just a methyl group. So what is an acyl CoA? Well, an acyl CoA is when the CoA right here is attached to our acyl group. Now notice we can call this with confidence an acyl group because we have one carbon here and an R, which guarantees at least one more carbon, which eliminates the possibility of this being an acetyl group. In this case, our CoA is carrying onto our acyl group and it's going to transfer it to wherever it needs to go. And now let's take a look at acetyl CoA. Here we have our CoA with the sulfur, and as you can see, it's attached to our acetyl group. In this case, notice how our R is just a single carbon, which is a methyl, hence we can call this compound acetyl CoA. Now that we know what acyl groups are and what acetyl groups are and the difference between them, where does CoA come to play? Again, we know that when CoA attaches onto our acyl groups, we call it acyl-CoA. And when CoA attaches onto acetyl groups, we call it acetyl-CoA. But why? Why do we need CoA to attach to these groups? Well, the answer lies in the fact that when CoA attaches onto these groups, it enables these groups to travel and connect to other molecules. So in a sense, CoA acts as a bridging compound that can connect molecules to our acyl groups or acetyl groups that they otherwise wouldn't have been able to. Acyl-CoA is usually formed during the mobilization of lipids. When a CoA molecule attaches onto the acyl groups of the fatty acid, and it allows it to be metabolized and eventually broken down to acetyl-CoA, where it can join into the central metabolic pathway to make energy. The CoA in acetyl-CoA helps the acetyl group join into the oxaloacetate compound so that it can enter the Krebs cycle. Let's take a look at all the different pathways that CoA take part in. First one here is the fatty acid metabolism, in which the CoA is required by the enzymes fatty acid synthase and fatty acyl-CoA synthetase. We know that in fatty acid metabolism, CoA will usually form acyl-CoA. In the central metabolism, CoA is required by pyruvate dehydrogenase and alpha-ketoglutarate dehydrogenase. And also, CoA is required in amino acid metabolism by the enzyme branched-chain ketoacid dehydrogenase. Notice the asterisk placed beside the last three enzymes, which represents that these enzymes are part of your TLCFN enzymes. This is more useful for students studying for tests than it does for real-life practicality, but TLCFN enzymes are the three enzymes listed here, and they are called that TLCFN because they all require the same five coenzymes: T for TPP, L for lipoic acid, C for CoA, F for FAD, and N for NAD. Now, I mentioned earlier that deficiencies in vitamin B5 is very rare because it's found in everything we eat. And because of that, these conditions associated with B5 deficiency, they're pretty low yield for any test you take. Having said that, some common conditions you can find in the case of a deficiency would include peripheral sensory neuropathy, which we have weakness, numbness, tingling in both your upper and lower limbs, adrenal insufficiency, alopecia, which is baldness, dermatitis, enteritis, and fatigue. And that wraps up the video on vitamin B5 and CoA. Hopefully you have a better picture of what CoA is and what CoA does, as well as the difference between acetyl-CoA and acyl-CoA. If you liked the video, remember to hit the like button. And if you really liked the video, join the team, subscribe, and help the channel grow. And as always, if you have any comments, questions, or topic requests, you can always write it down on the comment section down below.